ever since a youngin', I don't know no other ways. I've been ballin' for the moment, but can't sight of better days. You fell off and now you lost the shit, that you was just a phase. I became this on my own, no, this is not how I was raised.
So appreciate it, man. We'll try to get through this quick enough, give people enough value. Why don't you go ahead and just give yourself a quick intro, and we'll get rolling from there.
Yeah, man, I'm Jesse Washington. I'm a journalist, documentary filmmaker, book author, and I will still give you a bucket if you test me.
Hey, hopefully you keep that forever. I don't know how long I'm going to be able to say that. You know what I mean? I ruptured my patella tendon 4 months ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, man.
Oh, it's horrible, man. Yeah, it's all right.
You can come back, though.
You can come back, yeah.
Yeah, I did my ACL back in the day. I'm 54 now, and, you know, how the songs go, acts about me.
Right, right. You know, so still dunking the ball and everything. I know you got a recent video dunking the ball on IG.
I don't put stuff of myself working out or anything on the internet as a rule, but every year on my birthday, I'm going to get a dunk and I'm going to put it on the internet. So I got this year.
Good for you, man. You know,
if I could get next year at 55, then I could die a happy man.
I tell you what, at 5'10", it's going to be tough for me to do that at 50.
Yes, it will.
I got to use every bit of energy. Hey, you know what, man? I mean, like, I know you have the Rich Paul book that's real recent. I've seen you got the Whip Appeal podcast, which is Whip Appeal, which is really, really dope. I haven't been able to. Did you do any episodes yet? I haven't been able to check any episodes out yet.
Yeah, we just put up our second episode. And yeah, I guess I should add to my quick bio.
Go ahead.
That we do have a Whip Appeal podcast out, and the purpose is to really talk about the issues that are important to us. It's from an athlete perspective. A black athlete perspective, which I think is unique here in Western PA.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing about my bio is that I got two children who played Division I basketball. You know what I'm saying? And so I think that I like what you're doing, Rel, because the knowledge and the information that you're giving people is very accurate and realistic.
Yeah, thank you.
Which is short supply.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that if I can add to that perspective at all, it might be useful for your audience. But you onto something, man, and I support what you're doing for real.
No, thank you, man. I appreciate it. And, you know, I think that's kind of my whole thing is as I grow and as times go along, I realize that people are the most important thing, like 100% people. And that's from every aspect of this thing. That's from coaches, coaching high school teams. It's for people like me running private businesses. It's for literally just like, you know, everyone out there watching this, Jesse actually put me in contact with the people at Drexel, which quickly, oddly, in a weird way, led to a scholarship offer for one of our kids. That was his first offer. Like, all of the relationships, and you know this as a journalist probably better than anybody, but, you know, the relationships are everything. What they allow people to do is they open up doors for people who can open up doors. You know what I mean? And so, and I happen to be involved with kids, so I'm opening up doors for kids, which is probably more rewarding, you know, than I would prefer anything else. But it's just unbelievable how much the relationships matter. And especially as, you know, any young black kid out there, I don't know that the relationships get broadcasted and articulated as early as they need to. You know, how many bridges have you seen people burn? How many times have people burned bridges with you? How many times, you know, obviously one side of my family is obviously all black. So it's like the amount of, for lack of a better term, the amount of fuck you tone that comes from black families and just, you know, the things that the environments that they have to navigate and deal with, it's usually a guard up. There's usually a shield. Now, that shield is the same thing that makes you succeed, though, from what I've seen. You know what I mean? That shield is great for you. But, you know, I feel like, especially as a young kid, I was just myself at one point. You know, I'm quicker to say fuck you than to try to amend or so. How many bridges have you seen burned, even just in your field, when you watch a kid and you look at a kid and you're like, man, if only he would have understood this, that, or the third. Speak to that a little bit.
So the relationships are really paramount. When I was a young kid, I was a little bit arrogant in that respect. I was like, I'm talented, I don't need that. But I absolutely did.
Yeah.
That's how I got into journalism, was a friend of the family recommended me oh, you should apply for this job. I wouldn't even have known that the opportunity existed. So I think in disadvantaged communities, particularly in the Black community, we don't have those connections. We don't work to nurture them. I've burned a lot of bridges.
Yeah.
And even in my career right now as a grown man, sometimes I'm a passionate dude.
Yep.
We're doing creative projects, yep, or basketball stuff. I'll go a little too far.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll go back and say, hey, man, my bad. You know, and work to mend the relationship.
Okay.
So, I'm happy to share my network with people who deserve it. And a lot of people would ask me for a recommendation for a coach, but I don't feel that they would do the right thing with it or something like that. So it wasn't an accident that Elijah got an offer from Drexel.
Mm.
It was based on his ability, y'all's character, and the presentation. But please, definitely, audience, listen to what Rel is saying, and treat everyone with kindness and respect, even if they don't treat you that way. A lot of people be like, yo, he disrespected me, so I'm going to disrespect him. You don't have to.
For sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You can keep it at a high level, and then you never know who that person who might have done you dirty right now down the line be in a position of influence, or they just have enough influence to block you.
Right. Yeah. unfortunately, that's a real thing. You know, that is a real thing, especially in athletics, because, again, how often have you seen people not get an opportunity that they wanted, whether it's an adult with a kid or a kid with an adult? And that's the time. It's easy to do that as an athlete because it's a competitive sport. And I have to fight those urges myself. I'm competitive, so I feel like if you don't wanna do it, I wanna give you the finger and keep it moving, and tell you how I really feel. But you understand that you can't do those things. And in the basketball world, you got two Division I athletes. You know how small it is.
Very.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so yeah, man. And the it's interesting you mentioned the competitive aspect of it, because you could be a super competitive person out there and still be a good dude,
right,
or a good young woman. I'll give you an example. Preseason fall league is going on right now, and I have a son who's in the 10th grade. He's serious about pursuing this, so he's got a fall league game against I'm not going to mention any schools or
yeah,
any names or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm filming for the purpose of helping my son,
right,
elevate his game.
Mm-hmm.
And then after the game, the other coach comes up to me and says, yo, could I get the film?
Mm.
Actually, he sent an assistant. And I very politely, I was like, nah, no, thank you, sir. It's okay.
Yeah.
Because I'm just not like,
nah,
I'm not, not like the other team. Like, nah,
yeah,
man.
Right.
And so he's like, nah, I'm friends with your coach, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, nah, man, you guys have a great program. You're doing really good.
Yeah.
They spanked us. I was like, man, you're well coached.
Yeah.
Congratulations, man. You got a good team, but I don't really share film like that.
Right.
But very politely,
mm-hmm,
respectfully, what I'm saying? But still, I'm still a competitor, man. I'm not giving no edge, none of that.
Nah, as you shouldn't. I don't believe, I don't know. I've always been a little cynical with things like that. I always think nice guys don't win, what I mean? But at the same time, there's a fine line between being overly nice or not being overly nice and just being a jerk, what I mean? There's a fine line. And I think basketball players are sensitive, man. Like, it's easy to get emotional. Basketball players are easy to get emotional, especially when it comes to the relationships and the business. And I just think, I've seen so much, I've had so much help. That one little inkling how you helped, I could name 100 things like that have happened to me in my young life, just doing this for under a decade, it's just so imperative. And especially, so I'm trying to bring it back. Like, if you're a kid who is getting to school, if you're blessed to go play in college, and maybe you didn't have the best of resources in your youth, you're gonna be attached to basically unlimited resources with the network of people that you're gonna meet, especially if you play high level Division I basketball. Like, people don't understand I'm going to Vanderbilt next week for Monday and Tuesday to go hang out with Jerry Stackhouse and be at practice. And do you know how many things that Jerry Stackhouse and Vanderbilt can provide to any of the athletes in their program, like in all types of fields, And so I just think it's so important for kids to try to be, I always say athletes don't think like children. They think like athletes, they think like adults, the high level ones. And that's a piece of it, man. That's a piece.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. And, I was blessed to be able to help Coach John Thompson from Georgetown, the late,
yeah,
great John Thompson. write his book. I did that one before Rich Paul's. Mm-hmm. And he said something to me that I felt was very important. This man was a master teacher and student of young people and understood young people and athletes at a high level. Coach Thompson coached 4 Hall of Famers. Coach Thompson, the reason you know who Allen Iverson is because Coach Thompson took it upon himself to rescue him from a bad situation.
Mm-hmm. That man is right behind me right here. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah. AI. And he said, great athletes aren't great because they're rational. They're great because they're irrational.
Yeah.
And they believe, oh, I'm Allen Iverson, I'm 6 feet tall and can lead the NBA in scoring, you know. And so there's a certain amount of irrationality that we have to build up the belief to accomplish, to, you know, these great things. And then sometimes it's hard to dial that down. And so I think that that's where, speaking to all the parents out there, that as a parent, your job is to be super rational. Mm. The kid, the athlete has to believe. But parents, man, y'all have to really check yourself about what you know, what you don't know, what you have to learn. And for if you're a parent who has an irrational level of talking about your kid or belief that they're better than they really are, then it's not going to work out, you know. And that's the hardest thing, man. I never trust my own judgment about my children. And I've been around the block a few times because that's my daughter or that's my son. I love them, you know, and so I can't fairly evaluate them.
Yeah.
And for both of my kids so far who've been able to play college basketball, it was only when someone totally disconnected to me said they have a shot. I could halfway trust, you know, the coach.
Yeah.
I was fortunate that my kids played in 2 of the best programs around. My son came up with Wildcats before they were Wildcats. So shouts to Tom Droney and Nate Perry. And then my daughter played with the Bruins and John Tate. And these people are great talent evaluators. And so, you know, but I couldn't even really trust it. And when they said that my kids were Division I, I had to wait until like another parent told me, or another coach who coached a different program, because at the end of the day, it's still a business thing. And so parents, man, just be realistic, be self-aware, and check yourself.
You said that great. I mean, like, the kid needs to be irrational, the parent needs to be super rational. Like, that's literally the best way to put it. You know what I mean? I would love to hear you talk about, this is something that needs to be talked about more, especially I just said be irrational kids, but at the same time, I think kids need to understand that there is life after hoops, and what you do within your hoops, regardless to how it shapes up, that's what's really about to set up your life after hoops. And you yourself, you are literally knee deep in sports, but you don't play. You're not a professional athlete. Neither am I. And so talk a little bit about like how, show some light at the end of the tunnel for the kid who just texted me while we're right here. I know things may not work out for him as he wants it to. Like, shed some light at the end of the tunnel for some of the kids.
Yeah, man. So the number one thing is that everything that you're pouring into basketball, let's say you don't get a Division I scholarship, it's still worth it because you've developed characteristics and habits and skills that can make you successful as a parent, as a father or a mother, as a professional, you know. And I put these things in this order on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I have a child now who wants to play college basketball. I said, look, man, we're going to put all this work into it. And he is an extraordinarily hard worker. And hey, man, whatever the outcome is, it's a positive.
Right.
You know, whatever the outcome is, if you put your all into it, then you have to be satisfied with the
100%.
Result. So there's that first thing about, you know, the what comes after. So you're preparing for what comes after now in high school by having discipline, you know, learning self-restraint. Well, I really want to go play PlayStation all night, but I know I got this game, so I have to get my rest.
Yeah.
That is a life skill that will carry over. And then while you're, you know, what comes after, let's say you do get to go play college basketball and you're one of the you know, maybe I think 3% of all high school athletes play in college at any level, 1% play Division I for basketball, which is what we here to talk about.
Right.
And so in all likelihood, you're not going to play professional for nary nan a minute.
Right.
You know, and if you do, let's say you do become a professional, then you got 10 years.
Right.
That's a great career.
Great, yeah.
Now you're 40 years old and you have the rest of your life ahead of you.
Mm-hmm.
And what have you done to prepare yourself? Who do you know? What skills do you have outside of basketball? And it's really hard because those college coaches don't care about getting you no job.
Right.
They want you in the gym and in the classroom 24/7. So in all likelihood, if you play, let's say you have a great college career and play 4 years, 5 years, or whatever, you're going to come out with the resume of an 18-year-old.
100%.
Because you don't have any job experience.
Right.
It is good to have college athlete on your resume, but what can you do?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what do you want to do? What have you been exposed
to? How have you seen that in journalism? Like, how has that helped you in journalism, if at all?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think I have applied competitive nature to journalism. I want to get the story. I'm going to go the extra mile. Here, I'll give you an example of how so my college career as an athlete was extremely minimal. I scored 2 points in Division I basketball. You know, this is in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wasn't highly recruited or anything like that. I wound up on the team almost by accident. But I'm just a hooper, man. And that was I'm going to go get it. And if I'm doing something, I'm going to do it to win. And so I had an assignment a couple years ago. Remember when J.R. Smith forgot what the score was and messed up game one?
2016.
And they lost to the, you know, and then LeBron left. So everybody's blaming J.R. for the demise of the season, which was false. They said, Jess, Go do an article about J.R. Smith. Find him and find out how he's doing. Well, this is a tough thing to do. You know, how do we do this? So it's summer. There's no team structure. You don't have to be nowhere. But I'm on Instagram, and he's in Chris Brickley's gym all the time.
Mm.
I think this was 2017, something like that.
Okay.
He's in Brickley's gym all the time. So I go to Brickley's gym. Yo, what up? Boom, boom, boom. J.R. going to be here. Yeah, he's supposed to be here later. So we end up connecting with J.R. that way. But these athletes, when you interview them, it's hard to really pin them down and get a real
interview
like that.
Absolutely.
They don't trust you, et cetera. So I had an interview with JR, and I have most of the story, but I was like, man, I need to talk to this dude one more time. So I hit up Britt. Yeah, he's supposed to be here on Tuesday, but you know JR, he might not. Cool. I go from here in Pittsburgh, go to New York, go to the gym, show up at about 8, 9 o'clock, 4 p.m., 5 p.m. comes. No JR.
Mm-hmm.
I've been there all day.
Yeah.
You know, I'm taking jumpers.
I'll work out.
I'll go get a lift. You know what I'm saying? Real quick.
Yeah.
There's no runs going on. I ain't venturing onto the court to get dunked on.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so I'm there till probably about 6. So I stayed all day and no JR, but, you know, I drove 350 miles, whatever it was. So I'm like, all right, man, I did my best.
Mm-hmm.
Hop in the car, drive home. I'm on the Pennsylvania Turnpike. I pull over at exit 2-something. And go to get a snack, and who is there in the rest stop but J.R. Smith?
That's insane right there. That is insane.
I swear to you. It was crazy. I was like, yo, my man, blah, blah, blah. He's like, yeah, what up? You know, I just did it, you know. And so, and I pulled out my tape recorder. I'm prepared.
Mm-hmm.
Great interview. The story's out there. So long story short, if I hadn't put in the work, if I hadn't have been gone the extra mile, then I don't get – the story comes out on the first day of the next season.
Yep.
It gets huge traffic. It's, you know, it's a great piece. JR likes it. JR immediately retweets it. So that's just putting in the work. That's how that basketball can provide you with a foundation to succeed in life.
For sure. You know, and I said something the other day. I forget, and I said in my caption, I stole this from somebody. I just heard it like 2 weeks ago. I can't remember who said it. Somebody prominent, though, but they were saying that you don't build a professional athlete at 18, you build them when they're like literally like 3, 4, 5 years old. And it's stuff like that right there. Like what, you know, I have a 2-year-old daughter, and you know, at 2, it's maybe a bit much, but there's still things like I do things and say things and try to instill things because I know where I am myself and where I would like somebody like that to be.
But let me challenge that though.
Go ahead.
Yeah, if you build a professional athlete that young, but in order to be a professional athlete, and since we're talking basketball with people like that, you got to have a certain set of physical characteristics.
Yeah, hold on, wait. That's framed completely the wrong way. That's really the wrong way to say it. Framing a professional, I'm not a pro. I'm not a professional,
right.
But I have a professional mindset. You understand what I mean? So it's really the wrong way of saying it.
So those habits.
Yeah.
Those habits. Man, and that's what parenting is about. That's what coaching is about. There's a lot of similarities, and I think that's lost. You know, you said earlier in this conversation, Rel, people come first. And You know, this whole coach thing, when money gets involved, it's so hard to keep the type of basis that you have where you're actually helping kids and helping families. Mm-hmm. And that is your purpose and your mission, you know. And then I have no problem as a parent compensating people for their time in that respect. But today's basketball ecosystem has gotten so far away from that, where that care and that love mm-hmm. has really disappeared. And it just is purely transactional. And it's hard to, you know, it's hard not to be, because there's just so much high stakes and so much money involved now. And so just, I really commend you for keeping that level. And yes, to start pouring into these kids at a young age and giving them a mindset of success, it carries over from athletics to the rest of your life to professional. Hopefully we're going to be a professional something.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It could be a carpenter. It could be a plumber. It could be an executive. It could be a doctor. Whatever that is, you're going to be a professional at it. If you have this mindset that we could get through basketball, that's going to set you up for life.
Right. No, 100%. And that's really what I try to do. Like I've said before in videos that, you know, most of the kids that we ever see, they're never going to be really any good. Like, you know what I mean? Marginally, they're not going to even be what I was. They're really not, you know? And I was nothing special. They're not going to reach what I did. So, but that's not, and I think, you know, subconsciously parents understand that they're bringing them here for these other things. Like, they're bringing them here because they know I'm going to cuss their kid out in a good way. You know what I mean? Like, they know that I'm going to bring some confidence out of that kid who's just shy and awkward. Like, they know we're going to do that. You know what I mean? And again, I think that's just my upbringing, you know what I mean? And how we grew up and what our parents instilled in us and the people I have around me, my brother, my friends, you know? And so we just like outwardly project that. And before you know it, it just rubs off. It really does. And now you got a kid, maybe he still stinks, but guess what? Like he's in here. Like, you know what I mean? He's in here. His chin is up. He's not scared anymore. You know, and it gets no better than that, you know?
Yeah, man. There's a certain thing about athletes and ballers, man. If you got it out there, man, you could bring that type of atmosphere anywhere.
Yeah.
And so you're right. That is worthwhile. Man, to have a great high school career, to have fun, to play games, to be competitive, that's a lot to be said for that. And I don't want anybody out there to look down on that, like, oh, you only played in high school. Nah, man, that's a great experience. You could take that with you forever.
Mm-hmm.
And so let's be proud of that. Let's celebrate that. And let's help these kids to do that. Man, in the last couple of minutes, let's do a little rapid fire.
Go ahead.
You ask me something, I'll kick it back.
I'd love to.
You can throw a quick one in. Let's do a little something. Go ahead. Last couple of minutes. What's on your mind? Because I could ask a question.
I mean, literally, right here, right now, my thing is getting involved with the townships. Like, I'm trying to break down the barrier of getting involved with the townships and being able to.
What does that mean?
That means, like, when you have Peters Township in-house basketball and Bethel Park and Quaker Valley, there's a run by parents. That barrier needs broken down so that now when kids get to the high school level, they've actually been developed. And that's tough.
Yeah, the parent development is problematic. It's really problematic because unless you could play a little bit, and most of these parents couldn't play, not a bit.
Right.
But even if you could play a little bit, that doesn't mean you could teach the game. So yeah, you know, I don't. That would be good. The kids would be better off for that if you were running that.
Yep.
That's what I think. Best player you've played against in your life?
DeAndre Kane.
Give me a name.
DeAndre Kane. DeAndre Kane.
Yo, I played against Kane recently.
Oh yeah,
they got a run at Ammon, and Kane came in there, and you know he's, and then afterwards we played knockout, and so I'm it was like head to head.
He could shoot
old me and this guy, and like obviously he won, but just the level of competition, like. He came away and he was like, all right, OG, like, I respect you.
Yeah.
He's a great player. He's a great player. Best player Absolutely. For me is probably Katino Mobley. Had a couple matchups with him.
Okay. Silver hair
assassin. I'm sorry, no. Best player I've ever, not. This was not a one-on-one matchup, but I played pickup with Moses Malone.
Okay.
OG, one of the greatest centers of all time. John Lucas, the original. But Cat was the toughest. That was a matchup. We guard each other. And he was probably came to the pickup game on a Saturday morning. After being out all night, and I still barely keep up.
Well, hey, last question I want to ask you. Yeah. Where's your son at in his career? Where are we at right now today?
Yes, so my son Coltrane Washington, shout to him, has a degree in communications from Drexel University, played for 4 years, was there for five, but had an injury 1 year, unfortunately. Super proud of what he was able to accomplish and fight through. Had to fight through not getting playing time, getting yanked out early if you make the slightest mistake, mm-hmm. and just learn how to play defense, became the best perimeter defender on the team, mm-hmm. has guarded a ton of pros, and thoroughly enjoyed himself. Has turned down numerous opportunities and invitations to go play overseas. And he's beginning the rest of his life as a photographer, camera person. He's out here editing highlight videos.
Good for him.
We're working on a documentary together about Aliquippa football. So he's out there shooting and learning how to produce documentaries. And Coltrane is the producer of the Whip Appeal podcast.
I figured when I seen him in there, I'm like, oh, he got to be doing something. You're a young guy. He got to be doing something.
He does the whole thing.
Good for him.
He does the whole thing. He also gives us a young perspective, and let's be honest, I'm an old dude. What do they want to hear from me? But we got Coach Rita from Oakland Catholic, and my man Myron Brown, legend, played in the NBA.
Yeah, me and you gonna have to. I'm gonna have to give you a Myron Brown story. I don't really know him, but I gotta give you a funny story. We're not gonna do that right now because you gotta run. But I'm gonna have to.
No doubt, Myron Brown plays pickup basketball, an intense pickup basketball game that he organizes 3 times a week.
Okay.
He's still going strong. He's my
I'm sure.
Man. But that is life after basketball for Coltrane Washington. I'm super proud of him of easily transitioning into, okay, I'm going to start my career now and put this work in.
Good for him, man.
So appreciate you, son.
Hey, thank you so much, man, for coming on. We'll talk soon, man.
No doubt, Pete.
All right, you have a good one.